For as long as I can remember, I have loved going to the movies. There is something so captivating and transformative about film. How a gifted screenwriter can turn incredible ideas into powerful words, summoning drama, humor, and conflict from the page like casting a spell. How an actor who knows their part better than they know themselves can breathe life into those words, creating a character who until that moment only existed on paper, and a performance with the potential to be remembered for generations to come. And how a director with vision and imagination can bind those rare elemental creative forces, fashioning them into a gateway able to draw you into whole other worlds, holding fast to your senses until the closing credits roll, and sometimes, if the job is well done, for far longer. My name is M. Glenn Gore. I'll be your host each week as we explore in-depth the newest releases both in the theater and at home. You're watching In Like Glenn, and today we're discussing Star Wars The Last Jedi. The following video review contains spoilers for the film Star Wars The Last Jedi. Proceed with caution. It probably won't come as a galloping shock to you or anyone really to learn I wasn't an enormous fan of The Force Awakens. The new characters were fun and engaging, sure, but while everyone around me was carrying on like Tom Jones was in the building, I sadly found my enjoyment waning the longer the movie ran. While my friends were elated and relieved that Star Wars was back, we had apparently been robbed of it for a time by the prequels, I felt left out of the high, electing to mostly stay quiet in the after-show parking lot meetup so as not to rain on whatever parade I had obviously just missed. I wanted so much to love that movie, but I didn't. I liked it, for the most part. At the time, that was the best I could muster. And that's all on me. I accept that. I simply wasn't prepared for just how much of an homage slash tribute slash retread to slash of A New Hope it was going to be. Looking backward now, I honestly don't know what else I expected from master Xerox artist J.J. Abrams, whom at this point had become best known for his big budget replicas and, in the case of Star Trek Into Darkness, full-on rip-offs of other directors' films and styles. Alright, that's enough out of you. The decision to use The Force Awakens as a kind of $300 million reset button, God, it hurts to even say that, was instantly validated, however, when I reached the closing credits of The Last Jedi, the ninth and bleakest installment in the harder-to-kill-than-cancer, despite some downright Hank Aronian swings for the fence Star Wars franchise. Written and directed with near-vengeful execution by Looper's Rian Johnson, this film makes its predecessor look like 120 minutes of Muppet Babies repeats, both in tone and sheer thematic heft. And that's when I finally understood why it had to be this way. If we had started here in 2015, the auditorium following the first show would have been like this. You don't start with a chapter like The Last Jedi. You can't. A movie like this has to be earned, revved up to. It's a vault that requires momentum to hurdle. Picking up nearly where The Force Awakens ends, Episode 8 reunites us with Luke Skywalker surrogate Rey and Obi-Wan Kenobi surrogate Luke Skywalker, who has exiled himself to the island world of Octo following the wholesale slaughter of his students at the hands of Kylo Ren, because as far as I can tell, the Jedi retirement plan consists mostly of lose everything you love, seclude yourself on the dump planet of your choice, slowly come unglued. Rey, played with conviction by Daisy Ridley, whose craft has matured admirably in the last 2 years, is both at her applause-worthy strongest and heart-wrenching weakest in this outing. I applaud the filmmakers for being willing to say she doesn't have it all figured out yet. Backwards thinking and foolishly beholden to the idea of her parentage as the only means of defining her net worth, she is equal parts inner turmoil and outer hope. She holds fast to lore, to the past, which is her weakness and what makes her an easy target for Snoke, Ren, and the First Order. She's been raised on the legends of Luke Skywalker and the Jedi, only the first of world-breaking disappointments she would have to endure in this story. Shaken to the core by what she learns of herself, she soldiers on, determined to be great even if her name is not, to grow beyond what Luke and Yoda and all who've come before her are. She wants Luke to help her get the band back together, and by that I mean rejoin the Resistance, and hopefully school her in the ways of the Force along the way, but he's not having it. He's been to this square dance before, and would probably welcome having his other hand lopped off in lieu of taking on another wide-eyed, idealistic pupil.
Not again.
Seriously, Luke is a ghost here, a mere shell of himself, and outside of his stellar voice acting work in the Batman animated series, I have never seen Mark Hamill more confident. He is racked with guilt, swallowed up by the totality of his botched effort to save Kylo Ren from the dark side. He refuses Rey's call and answers with one of his own, put an end to the Jedi Order for good. Because in the end, what have they accomplished? For all their centuries of sermonizing, of pious policing and ineffectual oversight, the worlds are still at war. Only the names and faces of the combatants have changed. The old wisdom born out of the Jedi Council, and you remember what a fun bunch they were, has failed spectacularly to lead us into a future that is anything save for trial and fire. And this is what is mostly at the film's core. Notice that I said core and not heart. While Rey attempts to get Luke back in the game, on the other side of the galaxy, General Leia Organa, played as assuredly as she is elegantly by the late Carrie Fisher, leads the tattered scraps of the Resistance, and believe me when I tell you she is well utilized this time around. That it took us this long to see this Leia on screen is a crime. Supreme Leader Snoke, rocking a gold tinfoil smoking jacket straight out of Elton John's Goodwill donations, and the First Order have them on the ropes. Oscar Isaac returns as hotshot X-Wing pilot Poe Dameron, whose brazen recklessness at their last campaign cost the Rebels dearly, putting their surviving number on the literal run. He fancies himself leadership material, at all times attempting to save the day the only way he knows how.
So we blow that one up.
Which is very much the problem. His character arc in Last Jedi is so very satisfying, and I'll be giving it its due diligence shortly. John Boyega's Finn, freshly healed from his ill-advised run-in with Kylo Ren at the climax of Force Awakens, is also back in action. And by that, I mean he's once again attempting to desert the Resistance, a plotline I would be grateful if we could just let die. Unlike Poe's, Finn's character arc is unnecessarily repeated here. The difference this time is he is taken to task for his cowardice and selfishness by newcomer Kelly Marie Tran's earnest and sincere Rose Tico, a maintenance worker in the Resistance. This is a theme played thrice throughout the film, that being women who deny the ids and egos of the men around them who threaten, albeit unknowingly, to jeopardize everything at stake. She refuses to let Finn run away, opens his eyes to the true enemy every space battle and lightsaber duel thus far has failed to snuff out, and ultimately sets them both on a weird and arguably pointless, but not really, trek into RPG side quest territory. Meanwhile, Kylo Ren, whose path in this new trilogy is rapidly becoming its strongest and most memorable thread thanks in no small part to Adam Driver, finds himself at a crossroads. Rebuked by Snoke for his defeat at the hands of Rey and openly chided for his childish, misguided hero worship of Darth Vader, the seeds of one of Last Jedi's most jaw-dropping reveals are laid when he discovers he can force Skype Rey on the other end of the galaxy. These scenes are simply amazing. They do double duty as any good scene should, drawing these opposing characters into such close emotional and physical collision while also deftly expanding on the unknown capabilities of the Force. In a single movie, Kylo Ren has become exactly what I hoped he would be as this trilogy's big bad. In fact, he's grown into what I feared he might never be, and that is, following his defeat in Force Awakens, a legitimate threat. But in another subversion of our expectations for what a villain should and shouldn't be, Ren has shown himself to be so much more than a black hat. Full of conflict, desire, rejection, and uncertainty, his arc is more nuanced than Darth Vader's ever was, and while I don't believe he'll ever match classic Vader's now iconic and intimidating stature, what he brings in its stead is a different kind of menace. Kylo Ren is a wild card. Dr. Ian Malcolm would tell him,
"You wield it like a kid that's found his dad's gun."
Ren is vulnerable, unstable, impatient, angry, powerful, and now in complete control of the First Order, the largest military force in the universe. Basically everything you don't want a wild animal that shows up in your house to be. I don't know what happens next, but it's a safe bet it's going to be catastrophic. We see the Force do a number of things new to the Star Wars mythos in this episode. We witness Rey and Kylo Ren communicating telepathically across the cosmos, at one point even going so far as to actually bridge the physical barrier between them. We see Leia, in a moment that took nearly 4 decades to deliver, use the Force to propel herself through the dead of space, illustrating in seconds that she has been busy these last 30 years. And the coup de grace, we see Luke astral project himself across light years and whole worlds to confront his former student, proving in an instant that his mastery of the Force is beyond our narrow scope of understanding, and that for all his power, Ren still has much to learn. By the next movie, we're just going to be here. At first, I thought it was kind of absurd, over the top even. I mean, we've never seen anyone in the Star Wars universe do this, right? Then I realized I needed to shut up. Each trilogy has always shown us new aspects of the Force. The original showed us it could control minds, project illusions, levitate people and objects, and even summon lightning. The prequels compounded what we already knew of its ability to enhance the user's physical skill in the way Anakin could pilot a podracer, and in how Qui-Gon Jinn and Obi-Wan Kenobi could force dash through the Trade Federation flagship. It only stood to reason this new trilogy would present us with an updated set of Force powers and abilities, and it did not disappoint. After all, we haven't seen Luke and Leia in 30 years. We have no idea what they've been up to or what adventures they've been on together, though I'm certain they were fighting the powers of darkness side by side the way God always intended brothers and sisters to do. The Kung Fu lover in me really wishes we could see one final movie all about their training to reach their current power levels. I take that over a Han Solo standalone any day. Sorry about that.
Would that it was a single.
Storytelling is a language all its own. The longer you live, the more stories you hear, hopefully. And the more you read, the more movies you watch, the more you learn about plot structure, character motivation, setups and payoffs, and tropes. We know what tropes are, we see them everywhere and in everything, and while they can be fun, they exist for a reason. Tropes are the inevitable result of there basically only being so many types of story you can tell. Tropes lead to convention. Convention begets expectation. And expectation, particularly fan expectation in the case of The Last Jedi, is the mother of disappointment. The Last Jedi excels as a film, as a story, and as a continuation of the Star Wars saga because it knows the fans' expectations. It uses the false sense of security its 8 predecessors and, yes, everything else you've consumed up to this point have laid to subvert those expectations. After The Force Awakens released, there was barely a corner of the internet that wasn't buzzing with fan theories about where the saga would go next. Some of the theories were good, most were not, but they all fed into a narrative that it was our place as fans to ask for, even demand, those theories be validated by the revelations of the next installment. Was Rey Luke's daughter? Was she a long-lost Kenobi? And what about Snoke? Was he Palpatine resurrected? Was he Mace Windu's ghost? You can only imagine how Sam Jackson felt about that one.
Given that it's a stupid-ass decision, I've elected to ignore it.
We believed we were owed not just answers to those questions, but our answers. But here's the kicker. That mentality, that pervasive entitlement that has all but become the uniform of the so-called true fans everywhere on the spectrum from Rick and Morty to Steven Universe, it is flawed beyond reason and entirely self-defeating. Why? Because it can only lead to your complete and utter disappointment. These franchises owe you nothing, and obsessing over something does not entitle you to reciprocation or even an acknowledgement of that obsession. Rey's parents? Surprise! They were nobodies. They were actually worse than nobodies. They were the kind of people DSS would have had incarcerated. Rey is as devastated by the revelation she does not hail from Star Wars nobility, from a lordly line, as an embarrassingly large portion of the audience was, and that is not an accident. It's the best thing that could have happened. The Force doesn't belong to the Jedi. Greatness is not by pedigree. It's not as though only the Skywalker lineage can produce heroes. That's the equivalent of saying only George Washington's descendants can lead our armies. Only Thomas Edison's family is allowed to invent things.
Only I can live forever.
Only a noseless dickhead would say something like that. And Snoke's origin? Who cares? Snoke, at best, was a red herring, a boring placeholder designed to be such a blatant and laughable knockoff of Palpatine that we'd welcome his eventual and unceremonious demise. His origin or his true identity, even if he had one, would have been information valuable only to the audience. It would have meant nothing to the characters in the story. The Emperor didn't even have a name until the prequel trilogy. It was information no one needed, and having it wouldn't have made the movie better. I breathed a sigh of relief when Snoke was killed because it meant yet another shackle slavishly tethering us to the old ideas was thankfully broken. And while Luke's arc may not be what you wanted, it is what the franchise needed. A hero who cannot be broken is boring. A hero with regret, however, with a worldview shattered by crisis and failure, that is something else entirely. The future may not be in the hands of Luke Skywalker anymore, but his part in the story isn't over. Luke returned, in a fashion, at the climax on Crait, not to duel Kylo Ren in typical Star Wars fashion, but to buy time for Leia and the Resistance to escape, to keep the light alive. What the Rebels witnessed in that moment, one man standing down the First Order all alone, is the stuff of legend. It will be talked about for ages to come, and as evidenced by the final scene, will give rise to a new rebellion. This is why I said core earlier instead of heart. Hope is at the heart of The Last Jedi. Hope that we'll learn from our past failures and use them as fuel for the fire that lights a better tomorrow, instead of continuing the same sad and vicious cycle that has netted only wars of varying names and lengths and produced more corpses than it has heroes. Luke basically ended up in the exact same place Yoda and Obi-Wan Kenobi did before him, suggesting to me that being a Jedi is a path that just leads to isolation and regret. And let's be honest, what soldier doesn't come back from war without regret, without scars, even when that war is won? Han Solo and Leia's marriage was shattered by their son's turn to the dark side and subsequent deeds. It's harsh, but it isn't at all outside of the norm. No one ever wants to see their heroes change, which is tacitly unreasonable. I accept that seeing your favorite character ride off into the sunset is a fair indication they lived a long and happy life, but when you demand a visit after not speaking to them for 30 years, I regret to inform you you're sticking your head in the lion's mouth. The Last Jedi is, among other things, the story of non-legendary characters colliding with actual legends. Rey, a nobody, is tasked with persuading the Luke Skywalker to return to the fray. She battles for the soul of Han Solo's son. Poe Dameron, a pilot, must carry out the whims and strategies of Leia Organa. And newcomer Kelly Marie Tran's Rose Tico, a mechanic, is the reason Finn, hero of the Starkiller base assault, does an emotional third act about-face and goes from coward to attempted martyr. Having just lost her sister in a disastrous bombing run, thanks Poe, she has no time for deserters and offers Finn no quarter. Rose fights for the Resistance because she believes in what it stands for, not because she's the next in some renowned bloodline or gifted with amazing force powers. As with all of the new guard, she shows you don't have to have a great name to do great deeds. Throughout the film, she becomes Finn's moral compass and introduces both him and the audience to the true enemy responsible for all the galaxy's woes. And while we're on the subject of Rose Tico, I need to talk about the infamous Canto Bite sequence, so here goes. The scene has been lambasted as being superfluous and pointless, a side quest if you will, padding out an already daunting runtime. It also takes flack for not looking alien enough for an alien world, for resembling Earth too much, but I disagree with both sentiments. While the events set here don't appear to directly affect the main thrust of the storyline, I would argue that what we learn is worth the time spent. Canto Bight is a den of wealthy one percenters, callous moguls and technology barons who have made their fortunes by supplying arms to both sides of the war. They have grown fat off the suffering of entire worlds, Canto Bight itself being no exception, as we are treated to brutal scenes of animal cruelty and quasi-Dickensian children slaving away in poor conditions, all while set against the extravagant, frivolous lifestyles of the high rollers living mere meters above them. This is a first for Star Wars, an admittance that the battle is not about good and evil, but greed. Canto Bight looks like Earth because it is. We're looking at us, at our existence-old doctrine of propaganda and war in the service of material gain, and the sobering notion that if you want to uncover why a problem exists, all you ever need do is see who benefits from it. Star Wars has never been so bold. Now, I can't in good conscience get out of here without talking about Laura Dern's Vice Admiral Holdo, who takes over command of the Resistance fleet when Leia is injured during an earlier attack by Kylo Ren in the First Order. She butts heads with Poe Dameron over how the fleet should be run, which leads to a mutiny and countless more Resistance losses. Last Jedi on three occasions depicts female characters taking their male counterparts to task for their inaction, as is the case with Luke and Rey, their cowardice, as is the case with Finn and Rose, and their impulsiveness, as is the case with Poe and Holdo. Poe wreaks so much havoc in this movie because he simply doesn't listen. He is hot-headed and reckless, and while these are commonly traits and behaviors male heroes are celebrated for in film, I applaud Last Jedi for exposing them for what they are. Dangerous, immature, and yes, toxic. The era of the loose canon, the Mavericks, the John McClanes, Martin Riggses, the Dirty Harrys, and yes, the Han Solos is over. These characters can still exist, of course, but it is no longer okay for them to be the only ones with what it takes to get the job done. So what about cons? Hey, knock it off. So cons. Oh yeah, Last Jedi has them. Some of them bigger than I'd like to admit, but they're in there. The pacing is, without denial, all over the place, particularly where it concerns the Resistance fleet's slow car chase to Crait and the aforementioned Canto Bight sequence. The former is never quite as logical or as tense as I think the film believes it is or wants it to be. It goes on for so long, and truthfully doesn't reach the nail-biting point until the First Order learns of the 30 small craft attempting to slip past them to the planet's surface, and then mercilessly opened fire on the lot of them. The latter, sadly, does slow the film's already questionable pace to a standstill. I wish there was another way to say it, but the detour into Canto Bight slays any momentum the film manages to build almost every time we cut back to it. This is dangerous, especially when you consider this scene ends up having minimal impact on the main plotline. That said, my biggest complaint is easily that at no point do BB-8 and his insidious First Order doppelganger BB-9E fight each other. Last Jedi goes out of its way to make us aware the dastardly and soulless BB-9E can clearly see his orange and white nemesis hiding under that trash receptacle. It goes out of its way to give us a menacing close-up of his cold, dead, lifeless eye. A doll's eye. An eye just barely hiding such malice as you can hardly fathom. And if BB-8 is capable of taking out three armed human guards, what wealth of lethal implements are housed within his shadowy foe's twisted mechanical innards? Lasers? Explosives? Is he just filled with chainsaw upon chainsaw? I guess we'll never know.
Disappointed!
It's no secret The Last Jedi takes a massive gamble, stepping boldly into waters heretofore uncharted in the Star Wars canon. Whether or not that gamble will pay off can't yet be stated, but it's fascinating to me the amount of vitriol this chapter has garnered when, if you look back, The Empire Strikes Back, now universally acclaimed as the best entry in the series, received a similar backlash from critics and fans. It too was deemed too dark, too bleak, and too aggressive a departure from the tone established by A New Hope, so much so that when Richard Marquand all but reset the board with his 1983 switchback to the status quo Return of the Jedi, a film that rarely cracks the average Star Wars fan's top three, it was met with praise and adulation.
Impossible to see. The future is.
This is true. What I think The Last Jedi needs most now is time. Time to let history decide how it's to be remembered. So to all those who felt it fell short of their hopes and aspirations, take a moment as well. In the meantime, if you need me, I'll be watching it for the fourth time. I'm giving Star Wars The Last Jedi 4.25 stars. That's it for today's episode. As always, thank you for joining me. If you enjoyed the show, please like, share, and subscribe, and follow me on Twitter for more updates. Until next time, you were just in like Glenn.